Hello, hello, welcome back. Thank you very much for being here for the second live stream of this day, this Saturday. Glad that you guys are here. You guys know that I love good lawyering, right? I love a good lawyering, a lawyer doing some good legal work. I love that. But you know what I love just as much? Good reporting. I really, really love good reporting. Even if that means that I have been out-reported, I've been out-reportered, however you say that, I've been scooped. Even if it means that, if it is good reporting, man, hats off to you, well done. And this has happened today. The Erie Times News is reporting on unsealed search warrants in the Rebecca Bieler case. This is, I can't show you any pictures of her because there aren't any pictures of her. And it, for those of you who are going to send me pictures of, what's her name? Rebecca Bieler Schmucker, I think is her name, who was on reality TV. That is not her. Okay. There are no pictures of Rebecca Bieler, our victim here. But we do have a picture of the man who has been arrested for her murder. It is alleged that he murdered her and her unborn child, who I am told was a viable child, about 4 pounds from what I understand. So that doesn't matter to me whether she was just barely pregnant or whether she was 9 months pregnant. I'm glad that they are charging the murder of the unborn child. But here is what has happened. And man, now I need to sneeze. What is happening here? Hopefully it'll go away. All right. The Erie Times News fought to have search warrants unsealed. And they were successful in getting those search warrants unsealed from Erie County. Because while the victim was in Crawford County, wow, I need to sneeze. The alleged perpetrator, Mr. Cranston, his home was in Erie County. And so in Erie County, the Erie Times News sued to get access to these warrants, to get them unsealed. And they were successful doing it. And they published their article today, this morning. It is linked below so that you can read it yourself. But what I've done just for the sake of this video is I've created a PDF so that we can go through it pretty quickly here. Okay. Here we go. I need to drag this out of the way. I know you guys can't see that, but I can. Here we go. Newly unsealed warrants in Amish mother's murder reveal more witness statements and evidence. And this is written by Tim Hahn. Good on you, Mr. Hahn. This is really well done. Okay, warrants unsealed in response to a challenge from the Erie Times News. Newly disclosed information includes what Rebecca A. Bieler's 3-year-old son said he saw when his mom was slain at the Sparta Township home. Okay. In probe of February 26 murder of Rebecca A. Bieler, state police got several sealed search warrants connected to Sean C. Cranston, the quarry resident charged with killing Bieler. Again, here's Mr. Cranston. And you guys know that I was at his preliminary hearing a week ago. I think that was on the 15th. So a lot of this stuff we know, but a lot of the stuff we don't know because we saw it at the hearing, some of it at the hearing. Okay, the quarry resident charged in killing Bieler and her unborn child. All charges against Cranston were held for trial at a preliminary hearing on March 15th. That just means that it was held by the district court to go up to the Court of Common Pleas for trial. At the request of the Erie Times News, Erie County Judge David Ridge unsealed the warrants and their affidavits of probable cause. I have contacted my media liaison with the Administrative Office of Judicial Affairs, I think is what it's called. I don't know. There's an oversight office, and they have a media liaison who is awesome. And asking her if she happened to have the documents. She does not have them yet, so I do not have them. I think only the Erie Times News has them, which, again, good on them for their hard work on this. but as soon as I can get them, we'll be back and we will read them for sure. Let's see. Okay. Pennsylvania State Police learned that Rebecca A. Byler's 2-year-old daughter and 3-year-old son were home with her when someone entered the Amish family's Eastern Crawford County residence on the morning of February 26th and fatally shot and cut the 23-year-old Byler, who was nearly 6 months pregnant. Remember that Dr. Eric Vey ruled the cause of death gunshot wound and multiple sharp wounds to the neck. All right. The 3-year-old told state police that a green truck pulled into their driveway on Fish Flats Road in Sparta Township, and a man wearing sneakers entered the house and killed his mother, according to newly unsealed search warrants that state police obtained in their investigation into Byler's death. This poor little 3-year-old and the poor little 2-year-old. Oh my goodness. This is something else. It's my understanding that the 3-year-old boy, I'm not going to say his name. I think I accidentally put it up on screen in one of my other videos, but this little boy is closer to 4. In fact, he might be 4 now. Like, he was close to his 4th birthday. So he was on the older side of 3, I guess is what I'm saying. Able to communicate pretty well. Said he saw a green truck and that he saw a man wearing sneakers, which is recognizable for Amish children, right? There's no reason for sneakers to ever be on anybody that they know. Sneakers are something that the English wear, that the non-Amish wear. Investigators also learned from Byler's husband that 2 weeks before Byler was killed, a man made an unexpected visit to their house at night and inquired about buying their house. The husband, Andy Byler, believed the man's vehicle might have been red, but he was unsure as it was dark outside, according to information in the affidavits filed with the unsealed search warrants. State police developed more information about a red vehicle seen. So this is the first time that I've heard about the green vehicle at the house. And we have to remember that we're talking about a witness who is 3, almost 4 years old. He's 3, could be close to 4 years old. I'm sure at that age, certainly he knows his colors. But we also know because of the witnesses at the preliminary hearing, one witness said that the Jeep, red Jeep, was faced out of the driveway, and another said it was faced in the driveway. So either witness statements aren't really closely jiving, or perhaps there were 2 vehicles, and perhaps they came and went. And so one time they were nose out, one time they were back end out. You know, there are a lot of different possibilities here, but this is the first time that we have heard about a green vehicle. The husband believed the man's vehicle might have been red, but he was unsure as it was dark outside, according to information in the affidavits filed with the unsealed search warrant. State police developed more information about a red vehicle seen at and around Byler's home on the day Rebecca Byler's body was discovered. Among the information was that a man who at one time had driven for an Amish family in the area was seen driving a red Jeep on one occasion, according to information in the affidavits and information presented at a recent court hearing. The focus would turn to the red Jeep. I don't know if I remember reporting this back to you guys or not, but when Andy Byler took the stand, I believe he was the state's first witness in that preliminary hearing. He was asked about that incident where a man showed up late at night saying that he wanted to buy the house. And he was asked, "Do you recognize the man?" And he said, "I'm not 100%. Ms. DiGiacomo, the district attorney, pressed him a couple times, "Do you see him in the courtroom?" And he said something like, "I think I do, but I'm not 100%. Like, he was very clear that I don't remember perfectly. I think I see the guy in the courtroom today, but I do not, I'm not sure about it. Right. So that night, and keep in mind, for those of you who are city dwellers, when you go out into Sparta Township, PA, at night, it is dark. And I mean dark. There is no light pollution out there. Very, very little. And Mr. Beiler would have been using a lantern or something like that. He would not have been using, there aren't outside lights to the home that would have lit up the scene. You know what I mean? So, okay, focus would turn to a red Jeep. Additional information and evidence, including surveillance video and vehicle GPS data, led the state police to charge Corey resident Sean C. Cranston, who with his wife owns a red Jeep, of killing Rebecca Beiler and her unborn baby. Investigators have charged Cranston, 52, with criminal homicide of an unborn child, burglary, and criminal trespass. Titusville District Judge Amy Nichols held Cranston for court on all charges. That phrase is a weird one, but just so you guys know, anytime they say held for court, that means that it's moving forward to the next level court. It took me forever to figure out. Kimberly and I laugh about this. We were just talking about this a couple days ago, or maybe even yesterday, about words that and phrases that happen here in Western Pennsylvania that we are not familiar with, and words and phrases that we use that our friends and neighbors here in Western PA have no idea what we're talking about. Kimberly said the other day that she had used the word cul-de-sac, which where we're from is like a court. It's a dead end street that kind of has a circular shape to it. Houses are built around it. It's other people call them courts. Well, out here, there are no courts. There are no cul-de-sacs. They don't exist. It's not a thing. So nobody had any idea what cul-de-sac meant. Anyway, held for court is a phrase that took me a while to figure out. Just means it's going to the court of common pleas. Okay. And Judge Nichols was the one that was presiding over that preliminary hearing. Cranston, who remains in the Crawford County Correctional Facility without bond, now awaits formal arraignment as his case proceeds to trial. A motive in the killing remains unknown. And when I found out that there were search warrants unsealed, I was really hoping that it would say some kind of motive, but we still don't have that. I called the court yesterday, today's Saturday. Yeah, I called the court yesterday and I was asking because according to the UJS site, which is the statewide court site here in Pennsylvania, the docket was not showing up in the Court of Common Pleas and it was showing up as closed on the Magisterial District Court. So I called the court to find out what was happening, and the court clerk told me that they just hadn't received it yet. And I said, well, the next step would be his formal arraignment, right? She said, yes, formal arraignments happen every other Friday. So my guess, and there are other people that are telling me that I'm right, but my guess is that April the 5th will be his formal, let me look at the calendar real quick. Make sure. April the 8th. No, where am I going? I'm looking at March. Come on, Gavin. April 5th. Friday, April 5th is likely the day of his formal arraignment. And formal arraignment is actually kind of a short and boring, whatever they call it, proceeding. There's not tons happening there. He will be brought into the court. He will stand up probably with his lawyer. Well, definitely with his lawyer. He is represented. And the judge will read the charges against him and will ask him how he wants to plead. He will likely say not guilty. And then the court will say something like, I accept your not guilty plea, and we will schedule a pretrial conference for whatever date. That's usually what will happen. It'll be very, very short. I'm planning on going to the court, even if the docket isn't in the UJS system yet, I am going to go to the court. And while, you know, you guys are so patient with me, let me go to the UJS site and see if it's there as of this morning, just real quick. It would be in Crawford County. Let me just look at it. It'll take me a moment. Here, you have a look at Mr. Cranston while I'm doing this. Cranston, Sean, search. We do have a common pleas docket now. As of yesterday. Let's take a look real quick before we get back to the article. Okay, first off, case participants, Mr. Cranston, it's really interesting that they're charging him with a felony one criminal homicide, not an H1 criminal homicide. So homicide of Rebecca Byler, homicide of her unborn child, burglary and criminal trespass. Order denying motion to set bail came in, and original papers came from the court yesterday. And they're usually the calendar is right here. So we don't know for sure that he will have a formal arraignment on the 5th, but my guess is formal arraignment on the 5th. Okay. Thanks for bearing with me on that one while I look that up. All right, let's get back over here. Okay, 4 search warrants that state police investigators served on Cranston and his home and Jeep were obtained in Erie County, where Cranston resides, and were unsealed, and were sealed until late Thursday afternoon. Much of the information outlined in their affidavits was presented during Cranston's March 15th preliminary hearing, in which Crawford County District Attorney Paula DiGiacomo presented testimony from 15 witnesses and nearly 40 exhibits. By the way, and I'm sorry to keep going on these tangents, if you go over to my website, gavinfish.com, and go to this video right here, you'll be able to see my report on that preliminary hearing. And if you scroll down to the documents, you will see my notes in the preliminary hearing. So you'll be able to see a lot of the stuff that was probably in these sealed, the sealed search warrants, which hopefully I'm going to bring you guys soon. All right. Much of the information, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Testimony from 15 witnesses entered nearly 40 exhibits into evidence. State troopers outlined at the hearing how several witnesses reported seeing a red Jeep at and near the Byler's Fish Flats Road home on the morning of February 26th. How cell phone data from Cranston's phone and GPS data from the Jeep placed Cranston and the vehicle around the Byler residence that morning. The GPS showed... GPS didn't show that it was around the Byler's residence. Well, it did show that it was around, but it was showed that it was in the driveway of the Byler's residence. And how video showed the Jeep's movements from Cranston's home at 428 East Main and Corey to the Fish Flats Road area and then back to Corey that day. Authorities believe Rebecca Byler, who is estimated to be 21 to 25 weeks pregnant, was killed between 10 a.m. and 11 a.m. on February 26th. An autopsy determined she died of multiple sharp force injuries to her neck and a gunshot wound to her head, according to testimony at the March 15th hearing. They did not say how Dr. Vey came to the conclusion that she died between 10 and 11 a.m. that day. They just said that that was his conclusion and that he could testify as to how he got that conclusion if the case continued on to the Court of Common Pleas. There are 3 ways to determine time of death. One is through rigor mortis, one is through livor mortis or pooling of the blood, and one is through alger mortis or the body temperature. I don't know what the Crawford County coroner did. The coroners were at the preliminary hearing. They were outside. I saw them with their jackets on and the whole shebang, but they were not called to testify that day. So I imagine that the prosecution just kind of felt like they had a strong enough case that they didn't need to do that. But it's possible that the coroner, before delivering Rebecca Beiler's remains to Dr. Vey in Erie County, could have taken the body temperature via like her liver or something like that. But I don't know. Don't know. One witness who testified at the March 15th hearing was an Amish woman who said her family had gotten a ride one time from a man named Sean. This woman was impressive. She was an impressive young woman who was very deliberate and very clear in her testimony. I just was really impressed. Okay, who state police said they determined was Cranston. She also recounted how on one occasion, after the family was given a ride, the man she knew as Sean came to their home wearing black clothing with a gun on his side and inquired about going to church. Every picture that I can find of Sean Cranston, which I didn't prepare them for today because it was just very last minute, but he and his wife are always in black. Always in black, tend to be in black leather. He does have a motorcycle club jacket, like a vest on in a lot of those photos. It's hard to see the entire back, but there is an MC logo, like a patch sewn on a side. So I imagine it's a three-part patch, which means he would have been patched into that club. But he was always wearing black according to the photos that are online. Let's see. Okay. According to information in the unsealed search warrants, the family member of the woman who had first accepted a ride from Sean immediately got an uneasy feeling about him. From that first encounter in December through mid-February, family members said they had very odd experiences with Sean, who would randomly show up at their residence, according to information in the affidavits. This is more information that we got in the preliminary hearing. In the preliminary hearing, they basically gave us two examples of Sean acting strangely. One was in December and one was in January. But this seems to be that there are more than those. So that is another example of the preliminary hearing. Really, the only purpose is to convince the judge that there is enough evidence to move the case forward to common pleas. The prosecution is holding back what I think is a lot. And at the point of the preliminary hearing, the defense likely would not have had any discovery at anything at all. So they weren't really in a good position to make any good rebuttals or good arguments. Okay, on the day the witness said Sean came to the residence and inquired about going to church, family members told state police Sean was acting unusual, walking around their property, looking aimlessly into their fields, and his speech made no sense, state police wrote in the affidavits. The way that they described meeting Sean, the Amish have need of being transported to different places. They don't have motor vehicles, right? So they hire non-Amish people to drive them, you know, to different places, to the grocery store, to job sites, to wherever they need to go. If it's a distance that is beyond where they can reasonably get with a horse and buggy, they will hire people to haul them. They call them haulers, Amish haulers, or sometimes they call them taxis. So though they're not really taxis. Anyway, this family had a man living with them, an Amish man living with them, who knew a John Cranston, who called John Cranston for a ride, and John brought his father with him. So that's how they got to know Sean Cranston, according to that testimony. Investigators obtained contact information for Cranston. They drove by his Corey residence and noticed a red Jeep there, according to the affidavits and testimony at the March 15th hearing. Troopers talked to neighbors of Cranston who testified, who said Cranston's nickname is Rumble and they said he was associated with a motorcycle club, according to information in the affidavits. Among the surveillance video that state police collected in the investigation and played during the March 15th preliminary hearing was footage from a business located across from the Cranston residence. This video, this was the moment where I was like, man, I'm sorry, they got you. They got you, buddy. Okay, troopers wrote in the unsealed affidavits, and I can't wait to read these, that the footage showed a red Jeep Patriot returning to the Cranston residence between 1:55 p.m. and 2:02 p.m. on February 26th. By the way, they showed that video in the preliminary hearing, and it was like watching five clones of my great-grandmother trying to play video correctly. The poor trooper who was on the witness stand, who was a young man who knew the files really well, you could tell he was just like, please let me drive. Please just give me the computer and let me drive. It was painful. That preliminary hearing could have been 20 minutes shorter if they would have just let him drive. Anyway, according to the affidavits, a man is seen opening the doors and hatch of the vehicle and going in and out with items in his hands and carrying things to the side of a camper in the yard. Quote, it was apparent that this white male started a fire beside the camper because the camera depicted visible smoke rolling into the air, close quote. And that is true from the video that we saw at the preliminary hearing. There was smoke next to the camper, so it did appear that he was burning things. Additional evidence collected by state police in the investigation, according to the affidavits and testimony at the March 15th hearing, included a piece of dark-colored disposable glove found at the Byler residence and a similar glove in the trash at Cranston's home, and shoe prints from sneakers found in the Byler home. A trooper who testified at the preliminary hearing said a pair of Nike shoes, it was Nike Air Force One high-top shoes, with a tread pattern similar to the pattern found at the Byler home, were found under a mattress and a plywood door in the camper at the Cranston's home. So he had taken those shoes and had hidden them, allegedly, in a compartment underneath the mattress. By the way, for those of you who don't live out here in the Northeast, speaking of like strangeness, all of our homes tend to be tall with a small footprint. Whereas where we come from in the West, most homes tend to be short, one story with a wide footprint. The other thing is most homes have fences, like 6-foot fences around their yards, right? And out here, that's not a common thing. Like, I don't even think I've seen a 6-foot fence out here, like a wooden fence. In the almost 7 years that we've lived here, I don't think I've seen one. And what the camera was able to see from the business across the street was that Cranston was in his backyard, like in full view of the street, of neighbors, of the cameras, for sure. He was in his backyard for like 3 hours, taking things out of the Jeep, cleaning the Jeep, rubbing it down, opening it back up, rubbing it down again, taking stuff behind the camper, going back and forth, smoke billowing out behind the camper. I mean, it was like 3 hours worth of work that it looked like he was covering up. And prior to being at his home doing that, he went to a car wash where he washed the car spotless. He vacuumed inside the car. He vacuumed his own pants and stuff like that, like he was trying to get dust off of himself. And he was caught on video doing all these things. Okay. So the nitrile glove, the Nike shoes. Yeah. Okay. In addition to the Nike shoes and glove, items state police seized from Cranston's home during the search there on the evening of March 1 included a number of firearms, ammunition, a partial box of black nitrile gloves, and clothing, according to the inventory list of seized property, which I cannot wait to view. Real quick, I just want to check in to see if my contact is gotten back to me or not. It would be amazing if she has. I doubt it. Because I would love to see that list. Nope. Okay, she hasn't. All right. State police also collected DNA swabs and fingerprints from Cranston, according to case documents. So, and there were like 30 something swabs, I guess, allegedly, ostensibly for DNA at the Byler home. So I'm sure they will be comparing the two. Okay, fight for the release of the search warrants. And I'm going to read this because these guys deserve all this credit. Okay. Erie Times News, Tim Hahn, good on ya. The sealed search warrants for Cranston, his home, and the Jeep were unsealed on Thursday following a challenge by the Erie Times News through its parent company, Gannett. Erie County Judge David Ridge granted the Times News petition to have the warrants unsealed after a Crawford County District Attorney, Paula DiGiacomo, in an email sent to Ridge's office on Monday, stated she was not taking a position on the motion to have the search warrants unsealed. Ridge sat at a hearing on the matter Thursday morning, so 2 days ago. The Erie County District Attorney's Office, which handled the warrants because they involved the search of Cranston's house in Corey, deferred to DiGiacomo, who was not present at the hearing. Cranston's lawyer, Crawford County Assistant Public Defender Gary Kern, said in court Thursday that he had no objection to unsealing the search warrants. Erie lawyer Craig Markham represented the Times News. The search warrants were among six known to have been obtained by the state police in the homicide investigation. Investigators also obtained two search warrants for the Fish Flats Road home, which, when we have those returns, by the way, where Rebecca Byler was killed. Those warrants were signed by District Judge Nichols on February 26th and were served shortly after Rebecca Byler's body was found. Those search warrants were not sealed. So I'm wondering, on the search warrants that were unsealed, if it appears that they are just the search warrants that were unsealed for Cranston's home, not the at least three search warrants that we know about because of testimony at the preliminary hearing for cell phone data, GPS data, and stuff like that. So yeah, we've got a lot coming out here. I don't expect to be able to get these documents over the weekend. I mean, it was amazing. The AOPC folks who are media liaisons for us are amazing. I called her up and she answered the phone in two rings. I said, thanks for answering on the weekend. She said, no problem. What's up? How can I help? They're amazing, but she'll be hard pressed to get those over the weekend. So I will probably be able to get my hands on them on Monday. And when I do, I will bring them to you guys. Okay. Let's see if we've got any comments that we want to bring up here. Holly, she says, I'm sorry, y'all. Okay. Until proven aside, he just looks creepy and sus. Okay. He was just providing and serving for her family. Didn't deserve this at all. Awful. Yeah. We do need to be on the innocent until proven guilty side for sure, Holly. But the evidence that they collected against him that we know about so far seems very strong. I'm curious if there is somebody within Cranston's circle of friends and family, circle of associations, who own a green truck. You know, did that three-year-old little boy see a green truck? Did he see it? And if so, is there anybody in Cranston's orbit that have a green truck? I do not know. Yeah, the son saw it all. And I've been speaking to people in that community. And until I have permission either to share or I get corroboration, I probably won't share the stuff that they're saying. But now that it's been in the news, I had been told that the little boy had seen it and had been a witness for the state. Yeah. Keegan says kid said green truck, not red. Yeah, he did. He did. Didn't say red shoes. Well, he said sneakers. He didn't say a color on them, for sure. Mooney. I wonder if the almost... By the way, do you guys see that little star next to Mooney? That is because she is a member of my channel. Mooney is somebody who has been supporting me the whole time I've been on YouTube, and I just recently opened up memberships on the channel. You can click the join button below if you're interested. But Mooney, you have been supporting me for a long time. You came out to True Crime Convo. You're awesome. I love it when you comment. I wonder if the almost four-year-old is colorblind. Green and red mess with colorblindness. Right. So it turns out, Mooney, it turns out you are talking to a severely colorblind person. So I know a little bit about this. And I have red and green deficiency. The reason I know this is because I wanted to be a pilot and an astronaut. And in eighth grade, my dreams were dashed when I found out I had this color deficiency that I inherited from my grandfather. I ended up being a private pilot, but I really wanted to be an astronaut, and that was not in the cards for me. Anyway, it's very difficult to describe color blindness, but confusing red for green, at least with my red-green deficiency, would be almost impossible. You think about the way the cones and rods receive light at those at the different color frequencies. They combine them to create your color, everything in the color wheel, right? So if you're red deficient, you won't tend to see things less red or more green or something like that. The combination of the colors is slightly off, and it makes it so that they're, you know, shades that are close to one another kind of blend into one another. But as a pilot, I have to take a test every 2 years. Every time I get my physical, what happens is they call it a medical. Every time I go to get my medical, which for me happens every 2 years, I always fail it. And I fail it because of the color blindness. And so they won't give me what is called a first class medical. They will give me a third class medical. And then when I take that third class medical, that means that I cannot fly at night. So in order to fly at night, I have to get a special dispensation from the FAA. And that includes another test where I go out to an airport that has a tower and controlled airspace. Typically, somebody will drive me out in a truck to the farthest point of the property, and we will look up at the tower, and they will flash green, amber, and white lights at me. They never flash red. It's amber, green, and white. And I have to be able to say, that is white, that is amber, that is green. So I've done this. I've been a pilot for 24 years now. I've done it many times. I don't think that colorblindness would account for seeing a red Jeep and thinking it was green. Just I'm not a doctor. That's just my experience. Let's see. Keegan says, GPS, I don't believe is always accurate. I out GPS on my phone to go to Corey High School, and it took me way out of my way. So it is possible. But what you're talking about there, Keegan, is not actually GPS. You're talking about directions from a map interpreting GPS. So I don't think that that's actually comparable, respectfully. But your point is taken in that GPS is not always accurate. It depends on the receiver. Again, as a pilot here, I have a little more specialized knowledge about the GPS data network that we have, satellite network that we have that is in orbit specifically over the United States. Okay. A typical GPS device in an airplane will connect to about 21 to 24 GPS satellites at a time. And when you're connected to 21 to 24 GPS satellites, man, it will take you in so accurately close. In our phones, the GPS, and I've actually compared this in flight, looking at my phone versus looking at my GPS data in the plane, our phones still connect to something like 17, 18, 20 GPS satellites at a time. So they will give us, depending on your device, up, you know, close to within 10 feet, 20 feet. So if the GPS data was saying that Cranston's Jeep was in their driveway, then it could have been on the other side of the driveway. It could have been on the street. It could have been behind the house, but it's not going to be at, you know, Corey High School, for example. I know I'm making an extreme case here, but that's based on my experience. That is my opinion, but I take your point. It's a good point. Okay. We live on a very rural ranch. GPS is rarely accurate in our area. Yeah. I've never in flight, for example, I've never found that the GPS is more or less accurate, whether I'm flying over San Francisco or I'm flying over the ocean. It tends to be pretty accurate. I'm not calling you a liar or anything like that, but with the Jeep, it's going to boil down to what the GPS device in the car is capable of receiving, the signal that it's capable of receiving. How many satellites is it connected to? And so it, again, it's, I might be comparing apples and oranges and pears here, right? I mean, I'm talking about GPS systems in an airplane versus my phone versus a GPS tag on, you know, that a finance company placed in a Jeep that they had financed. I think that we'll find out through the course of the trial. Bo says your website is a true crime junkie's fix. It really is. It really is. There's a lot there, everybody. There is a lot there. And Mooney, you're so kind, Mooney. I love you. Keegan says GPS not always accurate, especially in the area they're at. That, again, for phones, that may be true because there is a data component with phones. I'm curious what we'll find out about the GPS receiver. Keegan says Crawford didn't want them unsealed, except that according to the article, DiGiacomo didn't take a position on it and the public defender was okay with it. I don't know. There's anything else, color blindness. What do I fly? Single engine land is what I fly. Lots of different things. Okay. GPS. Let's see what Holly is saying. It came out that, for example, Brian Kohberger used Strava, which is more accurate. Supposedly, I wonder if this suspect used Strava. Yeah. The GPS that they are following in this case is not his telephone GPS. They used his telephone. It was really fascinating, actually. The testimony was really cool, but the guy who testified about the phone, he basically said that he had all this data of Cranston's phone connecting to cell towers, multiple cell towers, but he focused on one cell tower for his testimony at the preliminary hearing. He said that he had other data, but he hadn't prepared it for the preliminary hearing. But anyway, he described how on a cell tower, they typically have three quadrants. Well, they're not quadrants. They have three sectors, right? Three quadrants. Come on, Gavin. All right. They have three sectors that each side has an array of antennas in the shape of a triangle. And then that sector is responsible for the signal in that area of the antenna going out kind of in an expanding triangle, right? And then he talked about how the radio signals between the tower and our phones are frequently updating, and that there's a constant speed at which it travels, which is the speed of light. So they are able to measure the distance based on pinging from the tower out to the cell phone and back to the tower, how long that took. And then they multiply that by the speed of light and can create an arc of where that person might be based on that speed, right? So they did testify about telephony, but the GPS was completely separate. It was because they had financed this Jeep, the Cranstons had, and the finance company, as part of their agreement with the Cranstons to finance it, put a GPS tracker on the car. And the police found out about it because the finance company saw that the car was in the police impound lot, and they called the police asking for the car back so that they could repossess it. So that kind of, to me, the car was only there for a couple of weeks and they wanted to repossess it. So either the Cranstons were way behind on their payments, or it was kind of a hard money situation, buy here, pay here, or something like that. All right. You're asking about the GPS. Yeah, it depends on how accurate, how many satellites that receiver is talking to at a time. Basically, for every data point that you add in, you become more accurate in your triangulation. So it really depends on what that receiver was doing. But keep in mind, Keegan, that according to the testimony, even if the truck was on the street, it was there for like an hour. It didn't move. It kept pinging. So, but it's good. Yeah. Garmin systems on flying machines are much better than our phones. That is sure. Robin says, I would think a fixed GPS on a vehicle would be spot on. They repossess cars all the time. It would be within a certain radius that would be, acceptable for the finance company, right? Let's see. Elizabeth, just catching this, have to do a replay. So you're part of the replay crew. Thanks, Elizabeth, for checking us out. Okay. All right. I think that's it. Thank you guys. Thanks for joining me today and, doing it even last minute. I will try to get these documents on Monday, which means I will try to get a live stream on this on Monday. And, if not, maybe Tuesday, but I will keep at it, trying to get these documents and then talking to other witnesses and other people that are kind of near the case. And as I get corroborated things, I'll report back. All right. With that, I will bid you adieu, and I will see you on the next one. Thanks for coming, guys. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below.